I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make its boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together, for the Lord is good. I said the Lord is good and greatly to be praised. Oh, taste and see. Has anyone tasted that the Lord is good? Blessed are they that put their trust in him. So y'all know what to do. Praise ye the Lord. Praise God in this sanctuary. Praise him in the firmament of his power. I mean, somebody ought to praise him a little bit more for his mighty acts. Somebody else for his excellent greatness. Let everything that still has breath, praise ye the Lord. He's brought you this far. We ought to praise him. He fought your battles. We ought to praise him. He woke you up another morning. We ought to praise him. We thank you, Jesus, for the goodness of God. Here in this land of the living, I want to thank God for my dear brother Nashby. Come on, let's put our hands together to praise God. For Nashby, we are so grateful for you, for your gift. You are a worshiper. I love it. I love it. He merged two things I love, hip-hop and hymns. Come on, y'all. I love it. I love it. And it's beautiful because this is indeed a throwback Sabbath. We're in a place where we were before, pre-pandemic. And this sanctuary, you're sitting in pews, right? So it kind of reminds you of some of the churches you came out of. And what I love is that the fact that many of our churches that we came out of that had these pews did not allow hip-hop in the sanctuary. But what Revision has done, what God has done through Revision, has allowed us to understand that we don't have to get rid of hymns and we don't have to stop hip-hop. They can come together. And we just praise God for how the Spirit has moved you to merge these two beautiful idioms, these two musical expressions of our people. May God continue to bless you. I want to give honor and thank God to the under shepherd who follows the good shepherd, the angel of this house, the pastor of this great church, this location where we are here, as well as they have built an amazing new sanctuary across the parking lot. They've also built apartments for those who are in their sunset years to serve the community. I want to thank God for my friend, my mentor. He calls me his son in the ministry, so I got a Baptist father in the ministry, Reverend Dr. William E. Flippin. He's not here, but let's put our hands together. Let's praise God for Dr. Flippin, First Lady Flippin. We know you'll watch this later. Thank you. Thank you so much for allowing us to come back here this one Sabbath, as we needed to be in a different space just for this one day. We're grateful for Dr. Flippin. If you don't know, he is a great, great champion of justice and equity in this city. He is a staple in Atlanta. We're grateful for his great leadership and kindness to us today. As we go through this, the rest of this year, the Lord's laid on me and for us to start this month during Black History Month. Who's happy it's Black History Month? Come on. Come on, come on. I see some of y'all got the assignment. You wore your African, your traditional African wear. And those of you who didn't, that's all right. You got a few more weeks to kind of hook it up. But we're grateful for our theme, which is strength to love. Strength to love, taken from the book, a collection of sermons from the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King. Strength to love is a collection of his sermons. We're preaching to the church to help us to understand the power that love has over hate. And for the rest of this year, starting this month, we want to be preaching and teaching under that theme of strength to love God, strength to love self, and strength to love others. We're going to be focusing on how we might strengthen all of our relationships so that we might be the disciples of Jesus, the champions of justice, the lovers of people God has called us to be. I want to let you know, today, as we come to worship Jesus, my heart is heavy as one of our great lions has gone to sleep in Jesus. Great Dr. Benjamin Reeves, the former president of Oakwood University, who was my president, and truth be told, one of the greatest preachers of the gospel that you could ever hear, has fallen asleep in Jesus this week. He leaves behind his loving family, two daughters, loved ones, mentees, admirers, those whom he has pastored, and those who he has shepherded through their educational matriculation. We are praying for the Reeves family and all those who are connected to them. My heart is heavy, not just because we've lost a great leader, but I've lost a personal mentor. This now makes two. And as we live in these last and evil days, there are so many who we are losing. I hope during Black History Month, you will remember those who have come before you, who have paved the way for you. And so as we walk through this shadow of the valley of death, I pray that you will pray for those of us whose heroes and sheroes are being laid to rest. Today, I want to preach in that spirit, if you will, of Dr. Reeves, who was a prophetic preacher on the sly. People didn't really know it because he didn't raise his voice, but spoke truth to power. And as Elijah was ascending, Elisha asked, "Lord, can I just get a double portion of his spirit?" I'm praying for a double portion of Dr. Reeves' spirit today as I preach this word. And in the tradition of the folk preacher, the Negro preacher, I don't know if you know this, but many of them, in fact, all of them, these old folk preachers, Negro preachers, did not go to seminary. They learned to preach as they fumbled through the pages of scripture, and the congregation would push them, and they would know if they were doing good as the congregation pushed the preacher. They would tell them, "That's all right, preacher." Let them know they were on the right track. I need that help this morning. In the spirit of that old folk Negro preacher today, would you stand to your feet? 2 Corinthians chapter 10. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. And I want to read in your hearing in the English Standard Version, verses 4 and 5. For those of you who are with us online, we haven't forgotten about you. We want you to worship right there in the live chat and be with us as we worship and as we hear God's word today. If you're ready for the word, shout yes. It's good to see y'all. So many of you found us today. Thank you for making sure that you found us. We'll be back where we were next week. But 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4 and 5. This is the word of the Lord. "For the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but have divine power to destroy strongholds. We destroy arguments and every lofty opinion raised against the knowledge of God, and take every thought captive to obey Christ." Ooh, I wish I had a church here today. Look, listen, verse 4. "For the weapons of our warfare are not," I like the KJV, "not carnal, but are mighty to God through the pulling down of strongholds. We destroy arguments and every lofty opinion raised against the knowledge of God, and take every thought captive to obey Christ." Today I want to preach as the Spirit leads me, according to not only the gospel in 2 Corinthians, but the gospel of the color purple. All my life, I had to fight. Would you turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, all my life, I had to fight. That neighbor didn't believe you. Find another neighbor on the other side, in front of you, behind you. Say, neighbor, oh neighbor, all my life, I had to fight. Father, have your way in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Some things should not be compared. The movie Color Purple should not be compared to the musical The Color Purple. The movie Color Purple is a film, brilliant film, adapted from the book written by the visionary African-American writer Alice Walker. And the recently released musical adaptation of The Color Purple was produced by Sister Oprah and a director from Ghana called Blitz Bazawule. And he lives right here in Atlanta. The two films are brilliant in their own right and should not be compared. Because one version relies on the power of words with carefully crafted phrases that have become part of the cultural canon of Black America. Y'all know what I'm talking about. If someone does you wrong, the phrase that you reach for is, until you do right by me, everything you think about is going to crumble. It's part of the cultural canon. Now, the musical version relies on more visual splendor and the power of music, which has always given our people hope. In the musical version, we get a look into the mind of Celie and how she used the power of her mind to transcend her present suffering. Both films are stunning, necessary, and painfully beautiful in their own ways. But there is one phrase, especially captured by the original movie, that reaches out to grab our collective conscience. It's when Sophia, played by Oprah, says, all my life I had to fight. I had to fight my daddy. I had to fight my uncles. I had to fight my brothers. Girl, child ain't safe. Isn't that what she said? Girl, child ain't safe in a family of men's. But I ain't never thought I had to fight in my own house. This is Black History Month, and this phrase, all my life I had to fight, means something to us as a people, doesn't it? Because since our ancestors were brought here to America in chains, we've been fighting. All our lives we've had to fight. We've had to fight an oppressive system. The system that put Black bodies of African souls in slave ships. The system that separated Black families. This system that tore, as one writer said, flesh from spirit. This system that sanctioned and encouraged the rape of Black women and girls. This system that used enslaved Africans to build America. All our lives we had to fight. This system that puts Black boys in detention and suspension for wearing their hair natural. The system that hypersexualizes Black girls. The system that outlawed the building of wealth for Black families. All our lives we had to fight. All our lives we've been fighting this oppressive system after building their economy, after fighting and dying in their wars, after dying for their flag, it ain't ours, after nursing their babies, after cooking their food, after taking care of their homes, ironing their shirts, and still taking their insults, all our lives we had to fight. And fighting is exhausting. It is the reason they do not understand, why it is that we must recall and rehearse all that has happened to us, because we must put into context why it is we can get a good night's rest and still wake up tired. It is the experience of those who have been historically and systematically brutalized, terrorized, marginalized, disenfranchised, subjugated, and therefore, when we sleep 8 hours, it is not always restful. For we know we must go and face those in our corporate America jobs with all of our qualifications, with all of our certifications, with all of our education, more qualified than our supervisor. And yet we must deal with the microaggressions of those who would, on the sly and on the low, question our qualification. This is the fight we fight all our lives. To be black in America is to be told you don't have to fight anymore, because you had a black president, and we now live in a post-racial America. The devil is a lie. Because if you don't fight, you'll lose everything. Right here in our great state of Georgia, in this city, Atlanta, that claims it's too busy to hate, the Republican legislature has already passed new election policies and laws that will restrict the voting power of black and brown communities all over this country, all over this state, specifically in the counties of Fulton and DeKalb, where y'all live. And this is, I hope you stay with me today. I'm going somewhere. This is the fight we must fight. Paul Lawrence Dunbar reminds us, this great Negro poet and novelist once wrote, "A crust of bread and a corner to sleep in, a minute to smile and an hour to weep in, a pint of joy to a peck of trouble, and never a laugh but the moans come double, and that is life." This is the life that we wrestle with. All our lives we have to fight this oppressive system. All my life I had to fight not just oppressive systems, but I had to fight oppressive ideologies. All my life, she said, I had to fight, but I never thought I'd have to fight my own people. I'm coming closer. Because oppressive systems are those colonial, those empirical powers, those European powers who have taught us a certain way of thinking of ourselves. But it's tough when you have to fight your own people who have taken on master's ideology. Some of you know what it is to fight oppressive systems out there and then have to deal with oppression from your own people. Black women are the most oppressed demographic in this country, because they are not only oppressed by the caste system of America that Isabel Wilkerson helped us to understand, but also through the medium of racism and misogyny, misogynoir. They catch hell not only from those outside, but those they come home to and worship with. Y'all gonna get real quiet? Black women have been abused and misused both from the slave master of yesterday and the domestic terrorism of insecure black men. You do understand this is the original context of the statement. You told Harpo to beat me? Sophia was stating her defiance, hear this, of the normalization of violence against black women perpetrated by men. Ooh, can I teach it, then I'll preach it? She said, I had to fight my daddy off. I had to fight my brothers. I had to fight off nasty uncles. Come here a little bit closer. Y'all had to fight off nasty deacons who hung out in the hallways and lobbies of churches acting like they were welcoming you when they were really sizing you up. Y'all had to fight uncles at the cookout who were seeing you as you were coming into your fullness of femininity and were taking down notes about how they might approach you to do ungodly things. Don't y'all get quiet here. Some of y'all had to fight your own people. Black women are not alone, for black men have had to fight. Where are you, my brothers? We have had to fight. Sometimes the emasculating statements of our own women who would dare to call us dogs. You know, black men are just dogs. And so there is this master's ideology that has infiltrated the minds of those who are the lineage of great ancestors, so that now we've turned on each other. And yet we have to keep fighting. Fighting to be seen, fighting to be valued, fighting to be respected, fighting to be appreciated. Listen, I salute all the sisters and brothers who keep fighting. But can I tell you, with this marginalized, the most hated demographic in America, black women, you have always been pushed to the side, even during the civil rights struggle. How come we only know the luminary names of Dr. King, Abernathy, Jackson, Vivian T. Jones, and so many others who are men, but we don't know those heroines, those sheroes, those women who were working to make things happen? We always talk about Dr. King, but what about Fannie Lou Hamer? We're always talking about Abernathy and Jesse and all the others, but what about these women, not just Rosa Parks, but others like Sojourner Truth before her, and like the great Moses, Harriet Tubman, who led her people through and out of slavery? What about those women whose names we do not know, who prayed in prayer meetings for our freedom? Where we fight our own. Do you know, on that great day when Dr. King made that great speech, that march on Washington, that there were very, very few women, in fact, on stage. The stage was full, replete of men, powerful black men who recognized in their masculinity that they were trying to speak for a people who were not only male. But as Dr. King was speaking, I don't know if you remember or if you know this, in those of you who have read the story, the account of the story, that it wasn't going too well. His speech wasn't hitting like it was supposed to. The great orator, Dr. King, was not really coming through, but it was the marginalized Mahalia Jackson, who they had sat, only brought her there to sing, was sitting on the side where most black women had to be during that day. And it was her, it was Mahalia Jackson, who had heard Martin talk about the dream at several other places, realized how hallelujah, and her prophetic understanding that it wasn't going too well. And she yelled out, Martin, tell him about the dream. And are we not grateful that even from the sidelines, black women have been telling us, helping us, counseling us, black men, on how we can be the best we can be? We've had to fight. All my life I've had to fight oppressive systems. I've had to fight sometimes my own people. Some of us have had to fight oppressive family systems. All my life I had to fight, but I never thought I'd had to fight in my own family. Ooh, y'all, don't get quiet right through here. You don't have to raise your hand, but anyone here ever had to fight your own family so you could be free? You don't have to raise your hand. I'll tell your story. I don't know your story, but I can tell your story. They used comparisons. They used competition. They used coercion. They used manipulation. They used neglect in order to get you to fall in line. I know I'm coming down someone's row. Save me a seat. I'm gonna sit down right beside you. They used conditional love, so that the only way you got their attention was to do what they dreamed you should be rather than allow you to be who God destined you to be. Dysfunctional family systems. It's the reason why when that family member calls, something pitter-patters in your heart and you don't feel good, because you know in the conversation you are going to be guilt-tripped or shamed into conformity. Y'all real quiet. All your life you had to fight, and it's probably the reason why you keep choosing those toxic people to date, because you were raised by a toxic person who taught you that you need to accept. I'm preaching, you ain't hearing, but I'm preaching. You were raised by a person who treated you in a way that you only got love if you do what they told you to do. Therefore, you date people who treat you the same way. All my life I had to fight. Not only oppressive systems, not only the oppression of my own people given back to me, not only oppressive family systems. Are y'all still with me? If you're with me, shout yes. All my life I had to fight even oppressive religion. All my life I had to fight, but I never thought I'd have to fight in my own religion. The truth is that in America, and in Great Britain and so many other places, religion was used as a tool to enslave our people. Christianity, having its primary roots, hear this, in Mother Africa, has been tainted, corrupted, and co-opted by those who erected this evil system of caste hierarchy. The use of the Christian religion to justify slavery has been well documented, but we must realize that Christian religion was not only used to excuse the practice of slavery, it was also used to negate the beauty of our ancestral African culture. Ooh, God. Christianity was weaponized to make us put down our innate and natural expressions of worship. That's why, you don't know this, but that's why you were conditioned and trained to be so still, so quiet, so unmoved when the Spirit is moving. They used the wrong interpretation of Scripture to tell us what was natural and acceptable to God, and every African expression, which is demonstrative, which is emotional, was called primitive and sinful. We naturally would dance before God like David danced. I wish I had somebody praying for me. And yet they used toxic religion to tell us dancing was sinful. That's why some of y'all can't keep a beat today. Because they taught you in our schools and in our Sabbath schools that you can't. We naturally clapped our hands in rhythmic praise to God in response to the Creator's goodness. And yet they use religion to tell you not to clap. And at our own general conference sessions, our president stood up and told us not to clap. We naturally embraced all of the emotion that comes with worshiping Yahweh, and yet they tried to eradicate our emotional expression of shouting and crying and lifting of hands and other forms of emotional display. We naturally, Lord Jesus, help me to preach this, embraced the importance of the drum. as the rhythm of the drum reminded us of the beating heart our Creator put in our chest. The drum that allowed us to worship God in syncopation, but also to give us the rhythms and the messages of freedom. And they deemed it unfit. So that now when I go to New York City, all my folks watching in New York, I can still find churches who are debating whether they should have drums. All our life we've had to fight oppressive religion that tells us we can't be who God created us to be. All my life I've had to fight not only those things, I've had to fight an oppressive spirit. I know I've been fighting. I know you've been fighting, but I never thought we'd have to fight. I never thought I'd had to fight in my own head. I'm sitting beside you now because the greatest battles that you've had to fight are the fights you have to fight in your own head. Where you are embattled by these ungodly thoughts that tell you you are not what God called you to be. Am I talking to anybody here who's had to battle and fight with thoughts? These depressive thoughts that cause you to believe that there is really no purpose, that it really doesn't matter how hard you try, that evil is always going to win, that your back will always be against the wall. I'm asking, do I have anybody in the building who's understood that you got a fight, and the greatest fight you are ever fighting is in your head? Paul said it this way: the good things I want to do, I can't and don't have the power to do it. And the things I want to stay away from, that's the stuff I'm tragically attracted to. And I wonder if I've got about 20, 30, 40 witnesses in the building who just wave your hands at me and let me know I'm not alone, that the greatest battle you've ever had to fight is the battle in your head. Watch this. Exterior messages have now gone into your interior. You have assumed the negative messages around you through the evil systems, through dysfunctional family, through people, black people who hate themselves, now they hate on you, through toxic religion that tells you you ought not be what God called you to be. And now here you are. You can't live and walk in freedom because the fight is going on in your head. And the greatest war we ought to be fighting is not being afraid of World War III. We should be dealing with World War Me. It's the war that's going on inside of me when I'm trying to be what God called me to be. I wish I had a witness, but I'm fighting the very flesh in me. He says, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. We've got to fight. But may I suggest to you that we're fighting with the wrong weapons. For even as I think about my people, there are some weapons we have picked up in our despair, in our justified rage, that don't work for us. Hear me, people. Paul says, I am in the text, I haven't forgot about it. Paul says, the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh. They are not carnal. Humanism is a weapon we've picked up in the struggle for liberation and freedom of our people. But humanism is carnal. It's of the flesh. What's humanism? I'm glad you asked. Humanism places the human being's intellect and power and agency at the center and makes no room for the divine. And there is a new idea in black freedom movements that say we don't need God. An idea that places human beings at the center of our struggle against evil. It rejects the notion, hear this, that evil is a spiritual entity in this world, and you cannot fight evil, which is spiritual, in human flesh. Furthermore, there is a humanism that rejects the claims of untainted Christianity. Simply put, here in America, you got people, black folk who are trying to fight for freedom, who say, I don't need you to pray. I don't need God. I don't need Jesus, thinking that the only Jesus we're talking about is the white version. I don't need any of that. You've heard them say this. We don't need the church. They had their time. Now it's our turn. Well, when I look at the data, what the black church has accomplished for its people is far greater than these movements that have pushed God to the side. Let us not forget that we have come this far by faith, leaning on the Lord. But since you look like you getting a little distracted, let me help you to understand. Let me come a little bit closer. Some of the weapons you're fighting with in your own fight are the wrong weapons. So if the marriage isn't working, we pick up the weapons of self-protection because I just want to be happy. I knew it would get real quiet right here. I planned for it. I put it in my notes. Congregation will be quiet here. We've picked up these weapons that are not biblical. We've picked up these weapons that are not in the pages of Holy Writ. We've picked up these weapons from this American individualism that teaches us it's not about the whole, it's only about the individual. And so we're fighting for ourselves instead of fighting for the marriage. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal. We're trying to fight the attack on our brains, the attack on our thoughts, the attack on our spirits with just good quotes online, with just speaking manifestations that many of them, not all, but many of them, all of these affirmations that are born out of humanism, which puts the power of the human mind at the center so that I can just think it will happen. The devil is a liar. He's trying to get you to pick up the wrong weapon. Can I tell you that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal? You can speak to yourself all day in the mirror, but if you have not talked to your Creator, who rules over heaven and earth, if you have not heard the voice of heaven that tells you, I fight for you, I wish I had a church here, if you have not rooted yourself in the faith of your ancestors, then I promise you nothing will really be manifested. You'll get a few successes, you'll have a few victories, but they will not be sustainable, because watch this, if you get it by yourself, you have to keep it going by yourself. I wish I had a few people here that know. So I'm just about through. Let me help you to understand. The weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh. They are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. And then he tells us what the strongholds are. It's arguments and it's opinions. It's right there in your text. It's the next verse. He says that we destroy, we come against and we destroy arguments. Stop right there. The argument Paul is talking about contextually is that he's trying to defend his ministry because people are making arguments accusing him of something that he is not. And he said, listen, we're not going to fight back by arguing back. He said, we destroy what they say about us, not by arguing back, but by having a power that is deeply spiritual. If y'all still with me, shout yes. What I want you to understand is that this weapon that we have, it's interesting, Paul does not mention what they are. He says the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. But when you read the Bible and read especially the New Testament, you'll discover even if you look at the lives of those our ancestors, how is it that they came through all that oppression with a faith-studying God? Here it is, real quick. Redemptive interpretation of the scriptures. That's the first thing. They reversed the curse of colonial interpretations of the Bible with a redemptive interpretation. Whew, okay. Seminary, I went to the same seminary all of our pastoral staff went to. Seminary never taught me how to see myself in the scriptures. We focused on individual salvation, but not communal redemption. European theological thought allows, watch this, always sanitizes scripture so that it erases the oppressive behaviors of those who are teaching you. Because they're not going to teach you to see your suffering in the scripture, because then it would indict them. So the reason my European professors in theology, in soteriology and pneumatology and all the other ologies didn't show me myself in the scripture is because to do that would be for me to turn around and hold them accountable. Oh, but thank God for those barefoot theologians who on plantations, who never went to seminary, got a little piece of scripture. Couldn't always get access to the whole Bible, but would steal little pages out of it. And even though they understood and their first languages and dialects were not English, they learned enough to read about Moses and how he went down to Pharaoh and got the Egyptians and got the Israelites out of Egypt. Please understand that our weapon, part of our weapon, is a redemptive interpretation of scripture. Do you know, just happened a little while ago, a preacher on 3ABN, that's a Christian network, I use that term lightly, 3ABN, told people that if you, this is what the preacher said, if you hear a preacher say the words social justice, you should run as far as you can. That was on y'all's station. This comes from a slave master theology that seeks to oppress. But our ancestors, oh, thank you, Jesus, knew that God was a liberator. They took the story of the Jews in Egypt and saw themselves, and they said, if God could deliver them, then God will deliver us. And I wonder if there's anybody here who's ever took God's word and did some redemptive interpretation, reversed the curse, and realized God is not against me. God is for me, and if God be for me, who dare be against me? Listen, you better start seeing yourself in the word. You better start seeing that if Daniel could survive a lion's den, then you can survive the lion's den at your work. I wish I had somebody here. If Esther could go unannounced into the presence of the king and change the trajectory of people, then you can walk into places they didn't think you should have been, and you can make it better for your people. I said you better see yourself in scripture. I told you David walked up on a giant and said it's time for you to go down. You better walk up on your giants and tell them it's about to go down. You better see yourself in scripture that even when Jesus was put in a tomb and everybody thought he was dead, early Sunday morning he got up with all power in his hand, and if he got up, guess what? You gonna get up. You better get up. Not only that, I'm running. Not only that, a redemptive interpretation of scripture, but our ancestors taught us to sing songs of hope in the midst of hopeless times. They would sing songs while picking cotton.
They would look at Master's house, brilliant, and say, everybody talking about heaven ain't going there. That was a prophetic rebuke. They weren't just taught. See, you were taught that that song was really about sinners. But that song was actually about oppressors. Because oppression of a human being who Christ died to save is the greatest of evils. They would sit and sing songs, steal away, steal away, steal away to Jesus. That double meaning of meeting down by the riverside, stealing away from the master's gaze, but also stealing away that one day Jesus would come back and steal us away from this world. They learned how to sing songs of hope. I learned about the Prisoners. Y'all ever heard about the Prisoners? It was a group that recorded an album in 1953 called Walking in the Rain. Watch this. The Prisoners record, these Prisoners record this group, record this album called Walking in the Rain while in state prison in Tennessee. These prisoners are singing about walking in the rain. But they have no access to the atmosphere to walk in the rain. They're in a prison, yet they're recording an album of hope that one day we're going to get out of here and we're just going to take our time walking in the rain. See, that's what our ancestors did. They had a song in their heart that defied the external situation that they're in. And if you're going to make it through, you better learn how to worship through songs that give you hope. That's why sometimes you got to encourage yourself. You got to sing and worship God to say hallelujah anyhow. I'm going to sing till I feel better. I'm going to sing till I think better. I'm going to sing. See, that's why Paul and Silas were not just praying in the cell. They were praising in the cell. Because how many of you know when you give God praise, things will begin to change? I thought I was talking to Bible-believing Christians who know that when you lift up a song of praise, God begins to move in that place. In fact, the Bible says that he inhabits the praises of his people, which is rich imagery, because if I praise him, God will get into my situation and I'll be broken free. Do I have about 10 people who have learned to sing a song in the shower while you're thinking about the stress of your workday, to sing a song in the midnight hour to tell you everything gonna be all right? You better learn how to worship. You better not wait till you get here. You better not wait for the praise team to sing your song. You better not wait for musicians to hit the right key. Is there anybody here that says, I don't need no praise team, ain't waiting for no choir, I'll praise him all by myself? Because when I think of the goodness of Jesus, I gotta go. How else did they do it? Not only did they do it through redemptive interpretation of scripture, singing songs of hope, our ancestors, they did it through the power of prayer. Oh, they knew how to pray. And not just in prayer meetings. Not just when they were in a crisis. Picking cotton, praying. Dealing, harvesting with rice, harvesting the rice, praying. Getting whipped by the master, their backs being opened up so that their open flesh was feast for the fowl, praying. They would pray without ceasing. And they passed down a lineage to help us to understand that the power is in prayer. That if I talk to God and I listen, he'll talk to me. And here's the secret to the power of prayer. It's not just saying something, it's hearing something. Because when you hear something from God, it cancels out what the old master used to say. Some of y'all are missing it. Because when we pray, it is not a one-way conversation. It's a conversation where I talk to him and then God talks to me and God tells me it's going to be all right. See, that's why in their prayer, they were able to come out of prayer and say, I got shoes. You got shoes. All God's children got shoes. Now, mind you, they're barefoot on the plantation, and they're declaring they got shoes. How do you do that? I'm glad you asked. Because when you spend time with God, and God talks to you, he'll tell you, you might not see it, but I got shoes on your feet. And is there anybody here who knows that prayer will change your perspective? It was Dr. King. One night, he writes in his book, A Strength to Love, that he was getting ready to give up in the month. Montgomery boycott. He said that he was afraid that he was getting death threats at first, but then they stepped up, they kept coming, and he didn't know what to do. He said one night he got up, Coretta was already asleep. He went to go make him a pot of coffee, and he broke down at the kitchen table, and he cried out to God. He said, God, I am afraid. Lord, I'm at the end of my powers. I have nothing left. I've come to the point where I can't face it alone. And Dr. King said it was at that moment through prayer that he had a divine moment with God, an encounter with the divine that changed his whole perspective. He said, little did I know, 3 days later, my house would be bombed. He said, I was calm. I was collected because I had been with God to understand that this was part of my journey. And I'm trying to let you know these little bitty prayers ain't gonna cut it with this fight that we're fighting. You've got to learn to get on your face. You've got to learn to call on the name of the Lord. I know you don't shout over prayer, huh? But is there anybody here that knows the only reason you're sitting here is because of prayer? Somebody prayed for me. Kept me on their mind when I was acting the fool. Took their time and prayed for me. And how you gonna make it? You gonna make it through prayer. Final thing. Our ancestors fought with the soul force of love. One thing about our ancestors, I hear people saying, and they must not understand our history. I hear people saying, I'm not my ancestors. And I understand their sentiment, but I disagree. Their sentiment is, I'm not just going to sit back passively and let people do me like that. Our ancestors, just let them. Just let those people enslave. I'm not my ancestors. You must not know your history. I wish you were your ancestors. I wish you understood the power of love that they showed, this soul force, this overwhelming power that overcomes evil. For love was not passive or weak. Their love was not giving in to oppression or giving up into despair. Love was their most powerful weapon because it takes more power to love your enemy than it does to hate them. I just said something. And love is the only power that renders your enemies powerless over you. Love is not passive. Love is not futile. Love requires truth-telling. Love requires confrontation. Love requires defiance of evil. I got to get you to understand what we learn from them is a realization that the only way to overcome is by loving God, by loving self, and by loving people. And as I get ready to take my seat, as we walk through these difficult days, this is an election year. There's a lot of hate that is going to be spewed through debates and through all of the social media posts. We will be pitted against each other. But can I tell you, the greatest liberator the world has ever seen practice love. For the Bible says he came to this world, that he spoke into existence, and the world did not receive him. He was born into a family and they doubted him. He called disciples. One of them betrayed them and the rest of them forsook him. He was teaching the people in the sanctuary. They were glad to get the miracles, but they were not faithful enough to follow him to the cross. He got to the cross, and while they're nailing him, he's showing the power of love. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. While dying, he took enough time to lean over to a fellow prisoner and say, listen here, today I'm telling you, you will be with me in paradise. The power of love overcame the nails. The power of love overcame the cross. And while they laid him in a borrowed tomb, it was the power of love that rose God, that rose Jesus up again. And what I want to let you know is that no matter what you face, do not take up the weapons of carnality, of your own human power, but take up your spiritual weapons. Don't you know you got more power than you think? The power of love is what will change this world. The power of love is what will change our communities. The power of love is what will change your life. For don't you know, the only reason you sitting up in church is because of the power of love. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. And you didn't come here because you chose to be here. The Bible says his loving kindness drew you here. So yeah, all my life I had to fight. But in the words of Dr. Benjamin Reeves, you remember those of you who were at Oakwood University during his time, in my opinion, he is the greatest president that has served. And he would, at graduation, we would all wait with bated breath as he would stand there. And at the end of all of the degrees being conferred, he would stand in his regal regalia and he would quote Thomas More. Hallelujah. He would say, I'm hurt, but I am not slain. I'll lay me down and bleed a while, and then I'll rise and fight again. I came to let somebody know, you might bleed a while, but is there anybody here who says, by God's grace, I'll fight again? I might bleed a while and lose a little sleep, but I'll fight again. I'm taking my seat, but can you help me close the sermon? I might bleed a while you talk about me, but I'll fight again. I might bleed a while you come for me, but I'll fight again. I might bleed a while disease rocks my body, but I shall fight again, because I got Jesus in me. And if I got Jesus in me, I've got fight in me. All my life I've had to fight, but the good news is I've never fought alone. Don't you know? No, he'll fight your battles. And if he fights your battles, you can praise him right now for the victory. If he fought your battle, why don't you lift your hands? If he fought your battle, you ought to give him praise. If he fought your battle, it's the reason you woke up this morning. If he fought your battle, it's the reason you got grace that met you on the sunrise. If he fought your battle, it's the reason you ain't lost your mind. I came to tell you, I'm glad today. I might bleed a while, but the reason I'm still preaching, after all the stuff I've been through, and the reason I'm still preaching, after all the hell I've caught, and the reason I'm still preaching, after all this stuff, is because my God has been better to me than I can be to myself. Hallelujah. Find the glory. Hallelujah. Help me lift him. He is the lifter of my head. So I will bless him. I might bleed a while, but I'll fight. I'll fight. Anybody gonna fight?
Listen, every person in this building standing, you're standing all over the sanctuary. Hallelujah. Listen, your head's bowed. I want to pray over some people who are getting a little tired of the fight. Because you've had to fight all your life. Systems on the outside. People on the inside of your life. Fighting the thoughts in your head. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They're not of the flesh. But they have divine power to do what? Destroy arguments. Hear me. Hear me. The enemy has made an accusation against you that you're not worthy of God's attention, God's affection, and God's salvation. These weapons I told you about today will help you to destroy that argument. Because the enemy knows that if he can get you to believe his argument against you, he's already won. He don't need your body. He just needs your mind. He just needs you to believe the argument. But you've got weapons in your arsenal to fight every argument he's made against you. The Bible says, you just read it, that these weapons help you to pull down every lofty opinion. These opinions that you are inferior and they are superior. No, the devil is a liar. The only thing that pulls that down are your spiritual weapons. I need some people here today who are saying, listen, I want God to help me, because today I'm tired. I've been fighting. I want to keep fighting, but I need strength. Like Dr. King, I need strength to know I'm not fighting alone, to pick up my weapons of spiritual warfare and fight till we cross over. If that's you, I want you to meet me at this altar real quick. I want to pray over you. I want to pray with you. I want to pray for you. Just meet me at this altar. I'm still in the fight, but I'm getting a little weary. I'm still in the fight. Getting a little tired. Still in the fight. Some stuff going on in my head. Stuff going on in my head that's telling me I can't make it. Come on, press right here, right in front of me. Press right here, right in front of me. There's some stuff. There's some ideas that are still stuck in my head that I'm fighting against. There's some opinions of people that are having their effect on me. Some things have happened to me. Or there's some things that I've done and the enemy's made accusations against me and my future. Right now, in the name of Jesus, in this place, God is giving you a new and fresh equipping. You've got everything you need to fight the enemy. You got his word. You've got your worship. You've got access to the throne of God. And you've got the power of love through Jesus Christ. You got everything you need. You cannot, you will not do this by yourself. I want to pray that you'll let God help you. Father, oh God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for equipping us with every spiritual weapon we need to fight this good fight of faith, to fight this good fight of freedom and equity and liberation, the liberation of our people and the liberation of our minds. Oh God, I come in the name of Jesus, your Son who taught us that love always overcomes evil. And it's your loving kindness that has drawn us not only to this place, but to many to this altar. God, I pray right now for those in this building, at this altar, and those who are watching online who are getting a little tired of fighting.
The fight is wearing them down. The fight threatens to steal their hope and their joy. The fight threatens to take their peace. But in the name of Jesus, we say, God, we acknowledge today we're not fighting alone. God, fight for us. Help us to know you've been fighting for us. Help us, oh God, to put down our own dependence, our self-dependence, our independence, and pick up, God, the weapons of warfare you've given to us. Teach us, Lord, how to read your word and to believe your word. Teach us, God, how to pray without ceasing and to call on the power of Jesus. Teach us, God, how to sing songs of hope in hopeless situations. And when they hate us, teach us how to love them. For you loved us in our sin. And we thank you for this transforming power. Now, God, this week, this whole month, and for the rest of this year, may we walk in power and authority. For the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but with divine power, we'll pull down every stronghold. We thank you in Jesus' name. Let everybody say amen. Amen. If God's spoken to your heart, put your hands together. Let's bless him. Listen. For today, at the end of this service, we're almost at the end, but at the end of this service, we will have some pastors down front. For those of you who want to make a decision for Jesus, for those who want to join Revision Church Atlanta, you're saying, I'm already a believer in Jesus, but I need a good church to grow with. Revision might be the right place for you. And so if you want to join today, you can be able to do that. We don't have the QR code today because we're in another location, but the pastors will be at the front to be able to take your name. Those of you who've been thinking about giving your life to Jesus, the Spirit of God has spoken to you today to let you know that the only way to win this fight that's going on in here is to let Jesus, your liberator, fight for you. You can hear and answer the appeal today at the end of service as the pastors will be here to receive you and pray over you. Has God spoken to us today? Come on, put your hands together. One of our pastors is going to come and lead us in our closing. And we look forward to seeing you next week. Remember, now on Second Sabbath, we are in person, so next week we will be in person as we continue to celebrate back over at Metro Atlanta. And then the week after that is our great 5th year anniversary. We'd love to see every one of you here. God bless you.
Who was blessed here in the building? Can you just clap your hands? I don't know about you, but I came in here a little weary, a little tired, but I feel ready to fight. Anybody else feel a little bit more energy to fight? Amen, amen. We are so happy that you have joined us here at Revision today. And we just want to remind you that next week we will be at our original location, Metro City Church. And we ask that you wear a black-owned business apparel or something from a black designer just so that we can celebrate once again this wonderful Black History Month. Can we say amen to that? Amen. We also want to remind you that we are having our youth ministry meet and greet. So if you are between the ages of 12 and 17, you can go right through these doors to the back and there will be a meet and greet for you to meet the other youth and to meet the youth leaders. We'll have some snacks for you. And even if you're not in that age range, we invite you to get some snacks, get some drinks, some juice, some water, fellowship also right through these doors back here. So as we end here, we just ask that everybody stand for our closing prayer. Let's pray. God, our fighter, our liberator, our helper, We are so thankful for the rejuvenation we have received here today. Lord, we pray that everything that we have experienced here today and we have heard will carry us throughout this week until we meet again. We ask for your safety as we travel. Now in the name of Jesus, we all say amen, amen. Revision, you are dismissed.
Our leaders will be transitioning to our orientation within 20 minutes. So if you are one of our revision leaders, we ask that you stick around, get some refreshments, and we'll be meeting in the back for all of our revision leaders for our orientation. That will be taking place in 20 minutes, so don't go far. All of our revision leaders. Thank you.